Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. We heard a lot about the global challenges during the day. I just need to. I will contribute the contribution that crop nutrition can make to some of the solutions. Matti has explained his view, which was a bit wider for agriculture, for livestock. I will address crop nutrition. Basically, my presentation is in three parts. First of all, I will explain the role of mineral fertilizers as part of the solution. Secondly, I will talk about best practice. We have heard a lot about best practice, and I would like to show you some examples of best practice at work, what it is all about. And the third part will be more visionary. How do we believe as Yara how we should change the approach towards crop nutrition, and what type of innovation might be available. I think fertilizer is part of the solution, and that we say because it is a fact that the crop needs nutrients as building blocks to grow. If there aren't minerals in the soil, the crop cannot grow, or others, it can only grow to the extent that there are minerals in the soil. If we talk about a 70% yield increase, it means a 70% higher removal of nutrients from the soil. So it is an absolute necessity that nutrients are available because they are building blocks of crops. And from trial data, we can see what would happen if, for example, there is no nitrogen fertilizer applied. The grain yield in this case will drop from close to 10 tons to below 6 tons. And if the soil would get depleted because the crop will continuously remove nitrogen, the yield will further decline, and at the end, in this long-term example, it was below 2 tons. So it is not debatable that the crop and the crop nutrients are important to achieve the goal of enabling the crop to grow sufficient biomass. In addition, the nutrients have also another function, because they are absorbed by the crop, and then they provide humans, animals, with the minerals they require. Nature has designed that humans and animals get the minerals from the food, and the food quality depends on the soil quality, which means the natural composition of the soil determines the crop yield, as I explained, but also the mineral composition of the crop and the minerals in food or feed. Basically, mineral fertilizers, and if we talk about fertilizer use efficiency, if we would do our job the best, all fertilizer applied to the soil will end up in the crop and provide minerals for the food chain. Just to choose another way to explain it, because many of us would say, where do I get the calcium for our bodies? And people say, it's dairy products, it's the milk that is a primary source of calcium. But if you take it further, the calcium in the milk originates from the cow, and the cow gets it from the grass it eats, and the grass gets it, of course, from the soil, and mineral fertilizer like calcium nitrate can make sure that there is plenty or sufficient calcium in the soil. That is in basic how nature has established how humans and animals would get the minerals that they are requiring, which means fertilizer also contribute to healthy crops and a good quality of the diet. These two facts, we need them as building block for the crops to create yield, but also that they are in principle safe and provide minerals for our diet is the main reason why we say fertilizers are part of the solution. If we talk about best practice fertilizer management, I would like to elaborate on two examples. One is from Tanzania in Africa, because the situation there is slightly different in the sense that we heard a lot about logistical challenges, knowledge, and so on, which means the farmers are lacking knowledge and competence. And this is an illustration of two brothers at a farm in Tanzania. And interestingly, because you would maybe immediately think this farmer doesn't use fertilizer. Yes, he does, but he uses any product that is just locally available, while his brother is using a product that we have developed and designed for the conditions in Tanzania. So this shows what type of effect we can get. So it was basically a bit without question that we would get a much higher yield with a Yara recommendation. However, there's a lot of skepticism against intensive agriculture globally and specifically also for Africa. So we initiated research to balance agricultural productivity and environmental protection. Basically, we invited the University of Life Science in Norway and the University of Agriculture in Tanzania to check about this balance, because a low input system also means a low output system. It means less impact per hectare, but more land is required. And if more land is required, what is the impact on biodiversity? But that has to be balanced against the high input, high yield, impact on soil, air and climate. First of all, if you talk about the result, the yield that has been obtained with a better recommendation, and in most of the sites we were able to multiply the grain yield with the Yara recommendation systems. This is an example of five sites. Regarding the environmental analysis, I don't show the data because of time. It showed that the emissions per hectare slightly increased in the higher intensive production systems, while the emissions per ton strongly decreased up down to 10% of what it originally was. And that is largely related to the fact that to produce with a farmer practice the yield that could be obtained, it would require more land. And more land means a higher environmental impact. So it is much better to produce more on the existing land. And that is why we talk about ecological intensification, which is to produce more product on the same land with less environmental impact. And that's what we are aiming for. If you look into Europe, this graph shows the nitrogen use efficiency in Europe, in European agriculture from 63 to 2009. I have chosen data from EU15 just because the statistical data are available, but I assume that it is probably the same, also if you would extend it a bit. If we just focus on the last 20 years, there we see a continuous increase in nitrogen use efficiency, which means more nitrogen is ending up in the crop, and that is what is desired. A higher nitrogen use efficiency is also beneficial for the environment, as you can imagine, and here are some data to confirm what we just saw. We saw the increase in nitrogen use efficiency, and there is a reporting of the nitrous oxide emissions from agricultural soils for the same period, and that shows a strong decline. And that illustrates a link between higher fertilizer use efficiency and lower environmental impact as we see it in Europe. By the way, Europe today has the world highest nitrogen use efficiency of any places. What was the reason? How did nitrogen use efficiency improve in Europe? And that is basically not rocket science. It was just to apply what is known in a very systematic way in many regions, many countries, which is first of all planning of mineral fertilizer management in a proper way and to include the organic fertilizers into these calculations. There was a question about recycling. Yes, of course, the organic manure, the products that are available at farm should be used at best. Then the application of organic fertilizers should be done most efficient so that they get the maximum use efficiency. Then to choose the right fertilizer products, and Europe has a privilege that there are efficient fertilizers like nitrates available to the farmer very easily, and the focus on balanced nutrition. And I would like to show an example of balanced nutrition. What does it mean? How important is it? This gives an example of a winter wheat yield. It's 100%. with all nutrients applied. That is what a farmer would typically aim for. And then we had a treatment where the sulfur was lacking. There is a minus 8% yield increase. If the magnesium wasn't applied, minus 26. If the nitrogen wasn't, so the potassium wasn't applied, minus 33. The consequence of that, if a farmer wouldn't have focused on balanced nutrition, the nitrogen use efficiency, because the nitrogen rate was targeted to this yield, is 85% under these conditions, and it would drop to only 57% in the unbalanced nutrition approach. And that is why a balanced nutrition approach in agriculture is absolutely essential to get a high use efficiency of the nutrients. If you think about future improvement, then we believe that we should really change the approach towards fertilizer management to crop nutrition. Today, many people, or the standard approach to crop nutrition is very much a mass balance approach. People say there is a yield target. I know this is a quantity of yield I would like to have. They know the quantity of nutrients per ton of yield, and from that they calculate the fertilizer requirement and apply it to the soil. And that does work, it is a proven concept, but it has a few shortcomings. Because yield expectation and yield reality is sometimes different, because the climatic conditions change annually, which means sometimes the crop yield is even higher than expected. Sometimes it's lower, which means to make a forecast on such a long period is a very static approach. Secondly, people do, of course, soil analysis to check how much or how many fertilizers are already in the soil and to compensate for the difference. And then is the question, how accurate is the soil analysis and is it really available? So as a consequence of many, many years of research in Yara, we have decided to propose a different concept to approach nutrition. And that is basically that we say the nutritional status of the crop determines the fertilizer application rate and timing, because we want to do crop nutrition. We should put the crop into the center of all considerations, and we expect a better nutrient use efficiency, as we can have seen in many trials. So that is also that we have to work from R&D, but on different prerequisites, like efficient fertilizers. We focus on nitrate fertilizers. We have to think about the balance of nutrients. We have to understand the crop requirements. We have sometimes to make a shortcut, because if we move the fertilizer application further to the crop, maybe foliar nutrition is a more appropriate way. So we are strong in foliar fertilizers, and we have to think about crop monitoring tools, because if we suggest to a grower to check the nutritional status, he has to have means to do it. So we have a Megalab analytical service, we have an end tester, and we have an end sensor. But all these developments were basically based on the idea to propose a different approach to crop nutrition to farmers. So the sensor was not developed because we thought it would be nice to have a sensor. It is an agronomic concept. It is to check, this is, by the way, this is a picture of the sensor on top of a cabin. It measures the nutritional status of the crop on both sides, calculates the nitrogen requirement, and adjusts the rate and gives a signal to the spreader of the quantity of fertilizer required while it is driving across the field. But the basic principle is that the crop should tell us how much fertilizer it requires, because that would allow an adjustment of the fertilizer rate in season to the crop demand. And from Matti, we have seen that because it was introduced initially in 2011 in Finland, that there are positive results, and I can also confirm from data from German trials that it was quite positive as compared to farm practice. We would not claim that it gives always 6% more yield or always a 40% reduction in nitrogen, but It depends, the effect that can be measured depends, of course, on the quality, how good a farmer, how advanced a farmer already operates. But on average of 23 farms in Germany, it gave a 6% higher yield at a 14% lower nitrogen rate, which means an additional improvement of the fertilizer use efficiency. More of the nitrogen went into the crop, and that is why we also base it, or why this is a suggestion for the Baltic Sea Action Group to explore this further. And Jürgen mentioned that we are committed also to look how to reduce nitrogen leakage to the Baltic Sea. And that is one approach, but in principle, it is a different mindset in crop nutrition. It is to put the crop into the center of fertilizer management. However, this is for nitrogen. If you look at the phosphorus, it is a bit more complicated because phosphorus is less mobile in the soil, which means the distribution of P in the soil is difficult to manage. And there is a lot of research ongoing in Yara to check how can we improve phosphorus use efficiency. We also did a survey of trials around in the Baltic Sea. And this graph shows you the result, the yield of barley from in Finland of three of soils in different classes. It was 15 sites with a low P content, 7 sites with a medium P content, and 13 sites with a high phosphorus content in the soil. If you now look, take first the yellow bars, which is a low soil P content, we see that the yield without phosphate fertilizer was much lower than the yield. It was almost 1 ton lower than if the soil had a medium to high P level, which means there was a big impact of soil fertility on the yield in the zero plot. And then what I found, or what surprised us a bit, was that if at the low yielding soil, the yellow bars, the phosphate rate was increased to 30 kilo at the highest level, it still did not reach the yield level as a medium soil content. Which means all the traditional literature about saying we need a certain soil fertility, we need a certain nutritional status of the crop, of the soil, is quite important for high crop yields. And that is a bit of a contradiction of a lot of environmental requests, that people say if the soil content is low and if there is erosion, if there's runoff of mature surface, runoff of soil, the P content of this runoff would be low, and it is a solution to take down the soil P levels, which is probably okay if you are from high to medium. There's a debate with the scientists, what is the right categories and so on, but it is very obvious that it should not go too low. And then it's a question, how can we find a solution to address P discharge if we say we also need to have a sufficient P level in the soil? And that was addressed through a research project. Jürgen mentioned it already. It was initiated by Chemira, and we continued with it at MTT, Sykkö and Yara. I think it was about a 1.5 million euro investment. It was a lot of effort in this research. And the idea was, can we keep the phosphate in the field and can we reduce discharge to water? And the principle how that could be addressed was the idea that we may stabilize soil particles by soluble calcium. To have a calcium source which is sufficiently soluble, if we would apply that to the soil surface, it would stabilize the particles and reduce phosphate leaching and phosphate runoff. And it was quite a success from a technical point of view. The product was actually applied in 2008. Still 2 years later, the phosphorus discharge was minus 52% lower than in the untreated field. And that is a way forward, but what we believe that we say, okay, We have to go for productive and environmental friendly agriculture. There's an extent to what crop nutrition and adjustment of nutrition can achieve. If this is not sufficient, we have to think about innovative solutions, how we can make a difference, and the positive effect are confirmed, and this is something that might be implemented in areas which are vulnerable to phosphate leaching and phosphate discharge. So to summarize my presentation, fertilizers are required to produce good crop yields and to provide minerals for the entire food chain. The more fertilizer nutrients end up in the harvested crop, the better the nutrient use efficiency and the lower the environmental impact. Implementation of best nutrient management practices has increased nitrogen use efficiency in European crop production, and agronomic research develop innovative solutions to balance crop productivity and environmental protection. Thank you very much for your attention.